Romans part 1, lesson 5. And this week we started, and we're still in chapter 1, and we started into what aspect of inductive Bible study are we starting into today?
The righteous and the unrighteous.
The righteous and the unrighteous, when we did some word studies, right? So this is another of our tools. It is a time that we don't depart from the text because it's based on what words are used in the text and how can we understand them better. Words that we use sometimes very commonly, and we're going to see if there's anything that maybe we didn't understand, a subtlety or a reminder. It may not be something you didn't know, it's just a reminder. But we're going to put ourselves back into Romans. We've looked at Romans as a whole, and what did we see as the theme of the entire book? The righteous shall live by faith. Right. Where do we find that in the book?
Romans
1, 16 and 17, right? And these are the very verses we looked at this week to look up some of these words. I had been saying that we're going to look up these words, and this week we did. What else did we see in the entire book of Romans? What kind of piece of literature is it?
It's
a letter or an epistle. Mm-hmm. And what do you know naturally about a letter or an epistle?
From somebody to somebody,
right. And from that, we learn some things. We learn things about the historic context, not necessarily a date of when it was written, but a time it was written in and what they were dealing with. So who wrote this?
Paul.
And who was it written to? Right. Christians at Rome, right? A church at Rome. One of the things that somewhat through our studies and somewhat through we've heard from Kay or maybe you saw in your commentaries is this church was not established by Paul, right? Because what did Paul say about himself? Wherever Paul went, he did not want to do what? Build on someone else's foundation, right? So he wanted to go places where he was going to be able to help them understand, either get saved, or in this case, there would have been some that were saved. But we also know with every group that is meeting that might think they're believers, they're probably unbelievers within it, right? Or looking in around them. Certainly Paul was an evangelist, and he would want to go to any area and evangelize as well, because he talks about sharing the gospel. But he also wanted to maybe help them understand some things better, establish them. Remember, he said that. So he doesn't want to go to a place where a foundation is already laid. So Paul had not been there. Paul had not established this church or laid this foundation, but also no one else had. Okay, so we can't exactly know, because it's never written in Scripture, how this group of people came to be, except for we know how some people at that time could have gotten saved. They could have been at Pentecost. Remember? They were visiting Jerusalem. There could have been people from Rome or that were going to Rome there, and they could have taken the news back to Rome and started the church there. So it just could have been a group of people that had gotten saved, had heard the salvation message, had gotten saved, and established a church back in Rome. But a person, Peter did not visit Rome and establish this church. No matter what revisionist history has said, Peter was not the established person to establish this church in Rome. That was a convenient story that was told at some point in time. So, and it was not in the Bible, right? That is, and so those are some things we can take just from Paul's statements. And so, but we don't know how and where the people that started the church in Rome, how they heard it or where they heard it. They could have been in some place Paul was or had been in Asia and gone back to Rome with it. You know, it could have been that. Because Paul met travelers, like in areas he was in, he met travelers and they took the message back to the area where they were from, right? Okay, and people like Lydia that he met and he taught her and she took it back to, I think it was Thyatira or somewhere. So, as we look this week, we understand a little bit about when we're talking about, who wrote it, who it was written to, and primarily throughout the book of Romans, he's talking to not just this church, I mean that's, but what is that church made up? What kind of people were making up this church?
Jews and Gentiles.
Okay, so some of his message is directly to Jews, or about Jews, and some of his message is directly to Gentiles, right? Paul was primarily an apostle sent to the Gentiles, but he never neglected the Jews. He always, every town he went to, his pattern was he sought out and spoke to the Jews first, right? And it even says to the Jews first and then to the Greeks as it talks about this. But we're going to look at these words. Now, I mentioned to y'all in an email this week, I love word studies. Let me just show you. I started writing definitions out. Look at my page. And there was like everything was good. So here, I started here, I wrote down here, then I wrote sideways, and then I wrote this way. And then I got some paper out and started writing. these were such great definitions that I just went crazy. So I was taking way more time than I was expecting, but it was all very good. Very, very good. So I hope you found that as well. But we're gonna focus on these two verses, 16 and 17, specific words in chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. These are the two verses not only do we get our entire book theme from, or the chapter theme of chapter 1 from, but we also get, they're just the key verses for the entire book. So really everything that Paul is addressing right up front after he introduces himself, kind of tells why he's talking to them and who they are, he launches right into one of the main purposes of Fry's writing and the theme of what he's going to write about. So let's read those two verses so that we understand. Like I said, if you go back to verses 1 through 15, you've got sections where Paul's talking about himself, kind of his credentials. We know that he is a bondservant of Jesus Christ. He's a called apostle. He was called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. Then he talks about the Romans, talks about wanting to go visit them, hasn't yet, and he does want to get there. And we know historically how he gets there is not the path that he expected.
Because he didn't get to Spain.
Right, he didn't go on. It wasn't on a trip to Spain, and he veers off to Rome. Mm-hmm. He went, how did he get to Rome? Let's just go there. How did he get there, Rome?
He was taken as a prisoner,
right, and arrested and going to trial. That was not, I'm sure, what he said, that's the way. Well, he would have said, if that's the way he planned on getting there, that's what he would have said there, and he didn't. He just planned on going to visit them. Okay, so in verses 16 and 17, it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation, for salvation, to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." I did include 18, sorry, so 16 through 18 there. In these verses, we have a contrast. There are two things revealed, right? What's the first thing it's told that is revealed? The righteous man shall live by faith, but in 17 it said, "For the righteousness of God is revealed," right? So what is revealed? The righteousness of God, okay? In verse 18, something else is revealed. What is revealed?
The wrath
of God. So we have this contrast, the righteousness of God being revealed. And I say contrast, but that's almost like I need to be careful, because I've said this before in us. I can be angry and I can feel love, but rarely am I going to be feeling anger and love at the same time. And I'm talking about the feelings. I'm not talking about the intellectual part of it, because I can love someone so much and want the best for them, I can be very angry at them for what choices they make. Like we were talking about earlier with the drug addiction that is so rampant, you know, that grandmother I mentioned loved her grandson enough, and the family did, that they wanted him to sit in jail because they could not see freedom as the best choice for him.
Angry because you love.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's coming out of that love. But we can also have the reactionary, "I'm just really mad at you." We can have that. And if I have that kind of reactionary, I'm just really mad at you because, like, you hurt me, you made me angry, whatever, usually wrong, then at that moment I'm not gushy feeling love, usually. God's not like that. God is everything that he is all the time. Everything he is all the time. And God is capital L love. He is the personification, the definition of what love really is. But he's also, it says here, the wrath of God is revealed. Also, he is wrathful. And we're going to look at these words. So, first word we looked at this week is what?
Power.
Okay? power. Since the New Testament, this epistle was written in Koine Greek, we're going to be looking at those Greek words. What is the Greek word that you looked up for power?
Dunamis.
Dunamis, right. D-U-N-A-M-I-S. Now, the Strong's number is 1411. Let me stop for just a second. Strong's numbers, we talk about Strong's numbers, and if you don't know what that is, there was a man named Strong who did a concordance. We call it an exhaustive concordance. The joke is it's so heavy it's exhausting. But the real reason for exhaustive means he literally looked every word in the entire Bible. Started with, if it was a, the, and, he listed it in the Hebrew or in the Greek.
Without a computer.
You're right. Without Google search. He did it, yes. Maybe, or typing at least. I'm not really sure. I'd have to look and see when it was published. But he just numbered every word. And there's a set of numbers that are the Hebrew or the Old Testament numbers, and then there's a set of numbers that are the New Testament, primarily Greek. But there's also Aramaic and Chaldean in the Bible. So when you use that book, and it's just little bitty letters and all that, he also gives minor definitions. They're very small. It's a great tool, though, where you can look up a word from the English. Now, and Strong's was based on the King James, so you have to understand that, too. So sometimes, like, your version might use a different word than the King James used, so you just have to know what they're the same original language word, but it was translated differently in different Bibles into English. So understanding that. So when we say Strong's numbers, he did all that numbering, and everyone else has used his numbers, which is great. Instead of every guy out there coming up with their own numbering system, they all just reference Strong's, even if they wrote their own tool based on another translation of the Bible. So when we say Strong's numbers, that's what we're talking about. And this Strong's numbers, 1411, would be the Greek New Testament numbers. Okay, your tool in the Strong, some are italics and some are not, and that would differentiate, you'd have to look, that would differentiate between the New Testament and the Old Testament. So when you go back to the lexicon in the back, which is like the dictionary, you would have to know which part of the lexicon to be looking in. Okay, it sounds real technical, it's pretty easy if somebody were able to show you. And if you're using a computer and you just hover over the word and it pulls up the definition, you don't even have to know any of what I just said. But I like to use books. So the Strong's number, if you went back and looked it up, look up under 1411 and you would come up with dunamis in any tool you have, whether it's a Vines dictionary, which I use that, or I have others called the Complete Word Study, New Testament or Old Testament, brought by Spiros Zodiotis. And I love his definitions. But there's other good tools. And again, if you're using a computer program or online, that you make sure you're looking at 1411 so that you know that you're looking at dunamis. Okay? From the word dunamis, though, comes what word that kind of is our English word that would help you understand what power is? Kind of what does it kind of sound like? Dynamite?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. That it is where we come from, the Greek is where we come up with our word dynamite, the idea of power. So it's not the best way.
It's a dynamic.
It is dynamic too, which means moving.
Spelling with D-Y.
Yes. Yes. And that's the taking from the Greek. This is the actual what we call transliteration, where they've taken the Greek letters and transposed English letters over it. So that's where you come up with D-U-N-A-M-I-S. If you go back to the Greek, this would be delta epsilon whatever. Okay, sorry. And that would be mu, that would be alpha, that would be iota, and that would be whatever. Anyway, dunamis. I can do some of it. So what did you find out, though, about dunamis? What was the definition?
Strength, power, ability.
Strength, power, ability. Okay, those were all words. Strength.
To perform.
Okay.
Authority.
Miraculous powers.
Somebody said to perform. Okay. And then you said miraculous.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else?
I found an interesting one, but it's not a word. It's a phrase.
Okay.
Ability to act or produce an effect.
Okay.
I thought that was really... good.
So ability to act or produce an effect.
I had ability to perform anything.
Okay, anything. So I'm gonna put anything at the end of it, okay?
And I had inherent character of God.
Inherent's interesting, okay. Inherent character of God, right? That's what you said?
Yes.
Okay, so what does inherent mean?
Natural.
Yes. Yeah. She's doing your hands like this. Yes. Yeah. Inside. That's always what I think of. It's inside. It's part of your essence of who you are. Yes. That's what she was doing with her hands. Right.
Strength of God.
Yes. So that would be, yeah. Strength. And we've said strength, but these are kind of used a little differently.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No. It's strength of it in and of itself, but you're saying strength of God, and that's part of the miraculous would be coming from God, right? So we're already seeing within this definition, there's kind of a generic dunamis, which is strength, power, and ability. But you begin to start seeing inherent in God, inherent in the character of God, strength from God, the ability to act or produce or affect anything. Who's the only one that can do anything?
God.
Right. Right. But the interesting part of this power in the text itself, it said, what is it referencing? Power of God, right? The gospel, right? It's for it is. Okay, I've got it marked. So the gospel, to put the it is, for the gospel is the power of God, right? So no, within the word power, we see inherent nature of God. But it's definitely telling you the power we're talking about here is not just generic power. It's the power of God. Now let's put it back with the gospel. The gospel is, like you could put an equal sign. The gospel is the same thing as the power of God. For what purpose?
Salvation.
Yes. It's specifically talking about salvation here. We could talk about a lot of things. But it's saying here, he's not ashamed of the gospel. Okay, why would Paul not be ashamed of the gospel? He's telling you it is what?
The power of God
for salvation. For anyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. That's the rest of the sentence. So taking that apart and looking at it, we're looking at the effect, right? We're talking about the effect. What effect we're talking about for salvation, right? Where is it coming from?
God.
And could only come from God.
One of the things I read in the gospel is so powerful. It gets people all the way to heaven.
Into heaven. She said the gospel is so powerful that it takes a person all the way to heaven. Think about that. Translates you from here to there. And we're not just talking about when you die. But it certainly is the outcome of that, right? Okay, so it's so important to understand the word. It's also understanding within the word we have this definition, but in the text it's telling us this power is from God, okay? Who does encounter to that? Who doesn't have this power? Who doesn't have the power to save
us?
Anybody else? Specifically,
us.
Yeah.
Us.
Us. There you go. Mm-hmm. So when you get to application on this, do you have the power to save?
No.
Have you ever been in a situation, and I was as a young Christian, with limited understanding, they probably weren't saying exactly what my mind said, but it sounded like it. I heard this phrase, if you haven't saved someone this past year, there's something wrong with you.
Oh.
And if you think I can save somebody, there's something wrong with you.
Right. But as a like fledgling, literally crawling Christian, I'm sitting there, my heart pounding, going, I haven't saved anybody. There's something wrong with me. What do I do? I got to fix this. I got to do. So I wanted a do. I wanted a, you know, action plan. Mm-hmm. And what might you be handed? And sorry, this sounds like I'm negative on this, but I might be handed, I don't have anything that looks like it.
Track.
Mm-hmm. Right? Do tracks have a purpose?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can they be powerful?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But, you know, just throwing that and running which some people have literally done. Here, you know, or, sorry, there's all kinds of applications. Most of them, literally, if you're passing them out, person walks two paces and throws it in the trash, okay? And that's not effective. Okay, so stopping and realizing and having it ripped out of my head that I saved anybody was number one. I saved no one. Right?
Right.
Where's the power?
God.
What'd you say, Sandy? Oh, sorry. The power is from God. It's of God. It has a purpose. It's going to affect something. The effect is going to be salvation. Okay? Yes, Sandy.
Okay, when you see someone, well, we've seen it in Christian movies, somebody dying.
Yeah.
And the person comes over and talks to them and ministers to them at that last moment.
Right.
He's introducing him to God? Or
right.
Is he just...
He's used as the conduit for the message. Yes. But that person doesn't save that person. But I get to be that conduit. Yes. So don't take from this, you do nothing. Because faith comes by
hearing.
And hearing by the word of God. Right? There's another place in Scripture that it says, you know, how can they hear unless... someone goes, right? So God, for whatever reason, uses these flawed people to have the mouthpiece and have the message. But the power is not in me. In the sense of, the power is in me in the sense that I'm saved and the Holy Spirit resides in me. That power is in me. But I have no ability to save a person. And sometimes that is said, sometimes that's trained, sometimes that's... So you can get into persuasive words, you know, if you're really good at it. This person's got all these notches on their belt. Where are your notches? I mean, these are things I've experienced. And I don't think that, well, maybe in some cases they really were saying that. But at least that is the perception that was being given, okay? So, number one, the beauty of this for me was all the responsibility is off me. Because you walk away from a situation where you have been used by God to present the gospel, and that person doesn't get saved right in front of you. You don't see it. But and you can walk away thinking you failed.
But you planted a seed.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And that you've planted a seed, you have no idea. I've heard 2-3 times lately, and this is just a thing to think about, no real, you know, don't put a lot of weight in this, but the idea that sometimes it takes 15 to 20 times for something to be said to a person before they change, right? You don't know if you're number one, if you're number 19, mm-hmm. or 20. You don't know. So when you do plant that seed, and that's the idea Paul also said, mm-hmm. one plants, another one comes along and waters, God brings it to harvest. Okay? That's what I'm really focusing on here is the power we're talking about here is effective. It has the ability, but that power is from God. And it's going to affect something, in this case it says, for salvation. Okay?
Funny, I was reading a commentary, Moody commentary at the bookstore yesterday, or Tuesday, and this was the definition. It said, in this particular area, power means the power of potency, an effective and transforming force and ability regarding salvation.
It's a great way of looking at it. I mean,
that's what you've been saying.
Yeah, it's what
along.
We're saying in these words, and that's where it's interesting to understand the definition.
Mm-hmm.
You also can know other places. If you see the word power, you can try and look it up. Maybe if you've got a tool right there, if it's the same dunamis, it might not be saying exactly that the gospel is the power of God for salvation. It might be talking about the power of resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
And that power of resurrection is in us.
Mm-hmm.
We have the same power. Now, I'm not saying I have the ability to resurrect somebody. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the same power that effectually raised Christ from the dead
mm-hmm.
is the power that God puts in us.
Mm-hmm.
Can anything get in our way?
Mm-hmm. No.
If God is working through me, can anything? Why do you think it is said that the gates of hell shall not prevail against you? Jesus said that to Peter, or to the disciples when he was talking to Peter. The gates of hell shall not prevail against you. Now, again, I used to think the gates of hell are coming at me. But gates don't come at you, do they?
Right. Yeah.
Gates are usually closed. Now, they can open and close. They can come at you like that. But they're not, they're hinged and driven into the ground, right? Gates aren't running around the earth after us, okay? So what, if there is a place, hell, there is, but if we were thinking about walking up to the gates of hell, what is it saying? They're closed?
And they remain closed.
Can they prevail against us?
No.
No. We can blast through. They're powerless. We can get through those gates. If you're talking about a fortress and the drawbridge is up, that kind of idea, the idea is for them to be inside and safe and the enemies on the outside. We are the enemies of hell. And those gates cannot prevail against us. Think about that. Because I used to think that hell's coming at me and it can't overwhelm me. That's great to think about. That's not what it's talking about. So it's also talking about we have to go and storm those fences, right? That's what it's talking about. That's our job, is to go out. So where are the gates of hell? Anywhere in this world, right? The domain is out there. All we have to do is walk out in the world, and we're coming up against those gates, in essence. Not that they're moving around, but basically that they're everywhere. They can't prevail against us. But again, only because that power is in us, not because I have power, not because I have ability, okay? What's the next word we looked at?
Salvation. Oh, I'm sorry. Salvation.
But you were right. Okay, salvation. Strong's number for that was what?
4991.
Sometimes I do this because sometimes people go afterwards and look these numbers up if they didn't have the numbers. So I want to make sure I put them up there. And you're right. Judy, what did you say it was?
Soteria.
Soteria. Because we all know that we are pronouncing the Greek perfectly. Just so we're all on the same page with that. I have no idea. So I would have said soteria too, because phonetically that's what it sounds. So we're close enough, right? God knows. What is this referring to?
The Savior or Deliverer. Well, that's soteria. From soter, deliverance, salvation, preservation.
Deliverance, salvation,
redemption,
redemption,
rescue,
rescue. Terry, you said one more. Deliverance, salvation,
preservation.
Preservation, okay. Anybody else?
Well, I found rescue, renewal, and restoration.
Renewal.
The three notions of salvation.
Okay, you're saying that they said rescue, renewal, and restoration. Three are all part of salvation. Okay, I like that. Okay, so the idea here is safety or deliverance or preservation. Those were the words Terry was using, and these others, rescue. It's really interesting, rescue, to me, because when I first started thinking about salvation, I didn't think of rescue. Because what does rescue imply?
Safe.
You're safe, yeah. Uh-huh. But you were somewhere else. You were in danger, right? So it's the idea of coming and taking you out of a dangerous situation, right?
Well, as he did with the Israelites in Egypt.
Absolutely. When you looked up this word, or when I looked up this word, there were many times it talked about the Old Testament Hebrew version of this word, but the use of the word in the Old Testament a lot of times was talking about getting them out of a bad situation, rescuing them, right? So a lot, not always, but a lot of the Old Testament references were the Israelites were in danger, an enemy had come, and God would take, you know, save them from that situation. And that's part of what this word is talking about. But in the New Testament, almost exclusively in the Greek, it's talking about our spiritual salvation, right? Not just rescuing out of a situation. It's great to know that God will do that too. We don't want to take that part away. So it's it has to do with, is there anything else, anybody? This is where I started going crazy with writing
death
things out.
Death to and freedom from sin.
Okay, death to. And freedom from?
Sin. Soul safety.
Soul safety, okay, like that.
A saving preservation.
Okay, a saving preservation. And what I want us to think about, because again, I talk about what goes on in my brain. It may not be a problem for you because my brain can be kind of weird. But when the word salvation, I tend to look at the word salvation and only think about the moment in time when God presented the gospel. The gospel was presented to me. This power of God saved me from my old ways into my new ways. And that's absolutely true. That is a part of this salvation. But even in what we're talking about, it can be rescuing you out of a situation. But when we're talking about the soul safety or the salvation of our souls, we're talking about something that's bigger than just our temporary circumstances. Much bigger than
it's
that.
It's eternal.
It's eternal.
That's the biggie about
absolutely. We have to understand that this has an eternal effect. It's eternal, the outcome of this.
Attributed to God only.
Okay, great. Attributed to God only.
Promised deliverance by the Messiah.
And that indicates, because the Messiah is referring to the Anointed One, and we know that's Jesus. But it was promised, where would we find that?
Genesis.
From Genesis on, yeah, Kay talks about that. All the way starting, the first promise was in Genesis 3. But coming all the way through the Old Testament, this Messiah was promised, but there wasn't just a person promised. There was a deliverance promised that was going to come through the Messiah. So that is an Old Testament concept. They would have understood, should have understood, salvation through the Messiah. They just didn't understand it. All of it, because it hadn't happened yet, and then as it did happen, some didn't recognize it. I've got, according to Jesus, to have salvation was to have the kingdom of God within the individual. Mm. So this has, salvation has a past part to it, a present part to it, and a future part to it, or an application, right? The past salvation might mean, like, all of us sitting right here can point to a time in our past. But it also kind of refers to we're saved from our past life, our past ways. But there is a point, and I can look back on when I was 29, when I got saved. Okay, that's the past part of my salvation. What's the present part of my salvation? How does salvation apply to now, this moment, today, when we walk out the door? How you live your life. That's the righteous man shall live by faith, right? How we live our life, definitely. It impacts a change from the past to now.
And a hope.
And that's the future. Yeah, we have a hope, right? But right now we're hoping. Yes, right now we're hoping in something that is future. Okay? So the past is from the penalty. It deals with, we're saved from the penalty of sin. Right, from our past actions that would have resulted in, if I had stood before God and died in my sins, as the Bible calls it, if I had died in my sins, unsaved, and I stood before God, I would have paid for those sins, meaning eternally apart from God. Mm-hmm. And there are people that will and have and will, right? But that's, I'm freed from the, saved from the past penalty, the penalty of sin. Right now, I'm saved from the power of sin. Okay? If I've died to sin and I'm walking right now, that means I won't sin, but I don't have to anymore. In the past, I had no ability to not sin before my salvation. Now, as I walk in this life, that's the difference. I should not be held by the power of sin anymore. I should be dead to sin. Where did we see that? Death and freedom from sin, right? That's the idea. Right now, as I walk in this world, I should not be held by the power of sin anymore. I am, I fight that, don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, we now have that enabling. That's what it is. And in the future, I love this one. I'm safe from the presence of sin. There's a time in my future, your future, we will never be around sin again.
Amen.
Yeah.
Bring it on.
Yeah. Bring it on. I mean, you really can get a hallelujah thing going here, because isn't that the most... I love the idea, no, I love the truth, the hope that we have that your uncle is now with Jesus. Praise the Lord. This body that was dying and decaying and holding him down, it's not holding him anymore. Praise God. We can rejoice in that. And he's with Jesus. There's so much that just blows your mind when you think of that. But the other thing is, with Jesus, we're not anywhere near sin. Isn't that awesome?
Mm-hmm. It is.
All of this stuff, all this list right here, all this stuff we were talking about, the drug addiction and these kids that are people that are in the grip of, or alcohol addiction, which is a drug, you know, that grip, that's the power. That really shows you the power of sin. And we may not be drug addicts sitting here, but we can have our own addictions. We can have our own issues and problems, our own, as one person put it, we all have that fruit from that tree that we tend to go back to. Yours might be a pear, mine might be a peach, but we tend towards that we're going to go back. It's also interesting that, so that's the past, the present, and the future aspect that has to do with sin. Free from the past penalty, let's have a praise for that.
Mm-hmm.
Free right now, I don't have to sin. I didn't have that ability before, but now I can not sin. Make sure you get the right negative in there.
Yeah.
There, I have the ability now, with God's power in me, I have the ability now to not sin that I did not have before. Everything, even good, prior to my salvation, was less than the way God would have done it. And the only way right now that I can do it the way God would have done it is if I get out of the way, if the Holy Spirit does it through me. And remember that Holy Spirit's in you. He has that power. He has everything. He's God. And so the only reason he's not acting through you is because you're in the way. And he won't push you out of the way. It's an amazing thing with God, why he does it that way. Don't you just wish in a way that he did puppet you? Right? That he just, like, just make me do whatever you want me to do. I'll do it. You know, take me out of it. But that's not the way he does it. So you die to sin, you become a new creature, and so when you begin to understand what this salvation all has to do with, especially because we're living in the present, when you begin to understand that you're not just talking about... The reason we have to understand this is Paul deals with this all the time. Remember, even the groups he's dealing with, is the idea that once saved, always saved. True concept. But the problem is, some people take that to mean, now I'm doing anything I want to do. Some people might call it, have you ever heard somebody call it a fire insurance policy, and they usually stick it in their pocket or something? I got my fire insurance policy. I'm going to have, got my ticket right there.
Free pass.
Yeah, and then I can live however I want. No. And within the book of Romans, Paul deals with all of this. It is such an important concept. There's part of the future that we're away from the presence of sin, but part of the future is also in the eschatology idea of, we're looking forward to, Paul writes about it in Thessalonians and other places, we're looking forward to being snatched from this earth. If we're alive and remain, we're snatched from this earth. We meet Jesus in the air. But those that died before us in Christ are raised first. And then we meet in the air, right? That's part of the eschatology of salvation. That's part of our hope, right? And that's still yet future. But another aspect of salvation is it includes all of the universe. Do you realize that? All of creation.
Before.
All of creation is waiting for what?
Birth.
The culmination of the redemption of man.
You mean all of creation other than earth?
All of creation.
The universe.
Everything in the earth and all of creation is held under and travailing and groaning and waiting for one thing. We're going to learn about this in Romans. The redemption of man. And that's the completed all of it, redemption of man. And so once that happens, what does God do to the earth?
Destroys it.
And then what does he do?
Remakes a new one.
Makes a new one. And we're totally freed from the presence of sin. And he can do that. That's right. He has that power. Brought it to, you know, it's like the old Bill Cosby thing where he said, you know, I brought you into this world. Like, yeah. Yeah. I mean, God created it all. He can do away with it all. And he can put it all back together. Right? Mm-hmm. If he brought, not if, when he spoke Adam into existence from the dust that he himself created, because that's what Genesis said he did, do you not think he can just poof that dust right back apart?
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
That, in my opinion, is probably what's going to happen at the rapture. All those molecules that are together and make me look like this are going to poof apart. I'm still, my spirit's still going to exist. But this body,
new body,
thank the good Lord, new body. No more Hashimoto's, no more any of that.
I was just thinking
that. Yeah. Who cares about that virus that's going to be okay. Beginning to understand this, we could dwell on this all day. We could dwell on this for 15 weeks. But beginning to understand this is critical because it has to do with how we live, how we are this righteous man that lives by faith, a righteous person that lives by faith. Not just the how-to, but it has to do with everything about it. And where did it come from? Me? I came, nope. Did I come up with the concept? No.
Nope.
Thank goodness. Yes, I would have totally messed it up. Thank you. For everybody. Start with me. Yeah, I would have messed it up.
Just because you're not perfect.
No. And God is.
Right.
Yeah. And it's so exciting to me. For me, beginning to understand this, I finally had a gospel message. Because I've been in that place that said, if you don't save somebody in this year, there's something wrong with you. And I'm thinking, then there's something wrong with me. You know? But they weren't right when they said that. But the idea was, you should be doing evangelism. That's what they were trying to promote. They were doing it so badly. And I'm immediately going, then I'm doing it wrong. And I can talk a lot. You all understand that. But you're immediately, you walk
no.
up to somebody.
Sorry.
Ask for God's power and he'll help you understand it. No, yeah, I it seems like I could talk to anybody, but have you ever been in that situation where you're talking to an anybody and you can't come up with the words to save your life or their life? I can't come up with the words to save their life because it's not about my words. And you can just like literally relax and breathe, send up what I call a flare, prayer, and just say, literally my mind just goes, God, sometimes no more than that, and then just allow him to work through you. Mm-hmm. It's in you, not just the power, but his word is. And when we went through the gospel last week, when we're going through these definitions, more and more of that's getting in here. And what has the Holy Spirit promised? Jesus said, don't worry in advance about what to say. The Holy Spirit will bring it to your remembrance. And so in that further prayer, it's like, okay.
Now.
That would be a good time.
And it's great. But also going out, and I don't always do this, each day with the attitude and the idea that I'm probably going to meet someone, bump into someone, maybe re-meet someone. Make me aware. Let me see things through your eyes. And God can do this. It's an amazing thing to just raise your awareness. You'll be walking along, you know, head down, maybe on the phone, and doing whatever, and then all of a sudden there'll be somebody, and you might see it as an interruption. But if you have that prayer, and you have that awareness, and you sometimes I don't even have that prayer, it's to God, it will still slap me up the side of the head and get my attention, not literally, but I can look at him and go, you'll just have that thing that washes over you, and you go, this is one of those moments. And it might be the simplest little thing. I will pray for you. can I pray for you right now? And or I'll pray for you. You might call them later. I meant to say this. I pray for you as I left. You can bless them. Or, you know, that person that you might meet. And I had a story somebody else told about encountering someone, and the guy asked for money. He was busy. He walked on, drove away, and came back and bought the man a shirt because the man was going for an interview. Hmm. Something simple. Buy the man a shirt. And this was actually a pastor, and he said, I still drove a mile before God got my attention. and it does happen. Anything else anybody wants to say about salvation? There, I've got pages, but I think we've gotten the bulk and the gist of it. It's awesome stuff, isn't it? Okay, so let's put it back in here. It's saying, Paul is saying, I am not ashamed of the gospel. It seems like a strange statement, but he's saying, the reason I'm not ashamed, I don't have to be ashamed. It is. The gospel is the power of God for salvation. Why would I be upset about that? Why would I be ashamed of that? Do we sometimes act ashamed? Mm-hmm. How can we act ashamed?
Because we act like we're afraid to say anything.
There you go. And what would be the fear? The power is from
rejection.
God.
Rejection.
Personal rejection. Mm-hmm. What are they going to think of me? Mm-hmm. It's going to be awkward. I don't want that. And literally, if you strip it away, and you're not thinking that at the moment necessarily. Mm-hmm. But if you really get down to why you hesitate, it sounds weird. I'm going to look weird. They're going to reject me.
It's going to hurt.
Yeah.
It hurts our feelings.
Right. Mm-hmm. I don't have the right words. Sometimes we'll lie to ourselves about that. Yes, Cindy.
But here's something unusual. I was having computer trouble, and I had to call Microsoft. And of course, I went to India.
Right. You talked to Peggy in India, right?
Somebody who was really very, I can understand him.
Right.
A very nice person. But at the end of the whole thing, he said, God bless you and have a blessed day. And I said, how?
Yeah. And then you can like literally do a small prayer and think, he's in a place I can't be. And pray for his impact there. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. I had an encounter yesterday where somebody looks at my business card and said, what's the significance of New Covenant? Because it's New Covenant Quilting. I said, because that's who I am. I'm a Christian. And she just smiled. She goes, that's what I was thinking. And I said, yeah. And I told a little bit of the story about like why, when I chose the name, we were doing the covenant study. Johnny was teaching it. And that was the idea, is that's who I am. And more often than not, you'd be surprised how many times just that name is a testimony and an opportunity that somebody will ask about. And then the chalice that I have as my image is not everybody recognizes what it is at first. Sometimes they'll ask, well, what is this? Purple, because of royalty. I love the color purple. There's significance in all of it, and I have an opportunity. They ask a question, I can answer it. You know, but understanding that you don't have to be perfect at it. You don't have to be good at all. First person that I had anything to do with, literally right there, she got saved. I've told you a little bit about this. I was kicking myself going, okay, the teacher in me, I made her mark up her Bible and underline the Roman road, took her from verse to verse and through it. Why did I spend that time? That was such a waste. I should have just been, you know, talking to her and the other two people there praying with her and everything else. But I love this, that God gave me this. She left my house and went to her house where her brother-in-law was staying with the kids. And there was something literally different about her countenance. Mm. That's what he said. No, not those words. But there's something different. What happened to you? She hadn't said a word. Mm. And she was always a smiling person. She was always a sweet person. So it wasn't like, you know, the scowl, you know, because you've seen that too. And so she said, she started talking to him about it. And guess what she did?
She saved him.
She opened up her Bible, and she walked him down the road. Wow. And I'm like, oh, wow. Thank you, Lord. And he got saved.
Wow.
And then within days, this is the most incredible story. Within days, she gets a call on her phone from a desperate woman who is thinking about committing suicide. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And she says, I'm coming right over. And she goes over there. And she takes her tool, and she walks this woman down the Roman road, and that woman got saved. But the best part of that story is that woman called her husband because he was having an affair with her.
Wow.
And she knew this. the woman that I had something to do with, she knew who this was and why she was calling. And she got up and took her tool that I'd helped her with a little bit, God's power, and took it, and that woman got saved. And her husband was in a world of hurt after that, because not like she wasn't addicted, but suddenly everything about him was exposed. And he didn't have his girlfriend to turn to, and his wife knew everything, and his brother knew everything. It was amazing. Mm-hmm. And he still kept acting like he was saved and whatever. But so don't beat yourself up if people don't just fall out on the floor all around you and get saved as a result. I don't have many of those stories that I can count on two fingers maybe. But that one, I was just like blown away. And I'm like, the most timid, shy person that wouldn't hardly speak to anybody, except she just was that background person you never even knew existed. And God used her as an evangelist. Would you have picked that personality? No. It was powerful. And that was all within the course of like 2 or 3 days. I'm just sitting here going, I was beating myself up because I made her market. Better things I could have been doing. I didn't have anything better I could have done for her that day. Because how many of you could have left that and flipped through your Bible and found all the things that somebody had told you? Mm-hmm. But I made it work. Anyway, let's move on. I could stick on this one forever. What's the next word we looked up?
Righteousness.
Again, this is another one we can camp out on all day. It's such an awesome word. What is the Strong's number?
1343.
What is the transliteration?
Dikaiosune.
That word. D I K A I O S U N E.
She's
good.
Okay,
I have it
written down. Long U. Or Y N E.
It could be. And that's one of the things you're going to find with different resources. They may transliterate some of the Greek letters a little differently. So instead of, which one is it? Where is the Y? In the D-I or D-Y?
I
think
it's Y-N-E.
Okay, Y-N-E instead of U-N-E. Okay. So, and that's okay, but we're still talking about this same Greek word. So sometimes the transliteration, the translation of the letters is a little different. So what did you find out about this one?
State commanded by God.
State commanded by God.
Observing divine laws.
Observing divine laws.
Observing.
A lot of justification in this one.
Okay.
The word justification is in this one a lot.
Right. Justification. Obviously, righteousness, that's a definition of this, but we're looking up that word.
Holy and upright living in accordance with God's standard.
Okay. Right with God.
Guiltless,
okay.
Opposition of lawlessness.
Okay, so an opposite, all right. So,
opposite of lawlessness.
So it has to do with a state of being or actions, right? It's not righteousness. There's righteous and there's righteousness. Obviously, they're going to be tied together, but this has to do with the conforming to, or it's a state commanded, but it's also an observation of those laws, all right? Within this, you start seeing God's standard, laws commanded by God, right? So you see within it there is a standard, right? Okay, the standard is set by who? God. I mean, I just said it, but yeah, let's just make sure we get that. Set by God, that's the standard. Through Romans, you know this already, we'll look at it later, but but we talk about all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, right? Mm-hmm. So you have this idea, this concept of there's the bar, it's God's standard, it's up here, and we can't get there. We can try. We're aiming towards it sometimes. Sometimes we're not. But we can't get there. We just keep falling short of it. And that's like the basic definition of sin. So it has to do with this standard. God set the standard, and he commands it. Righteousness. He commands that we are righteous. Right, or commands righteousness. He commands the observing of his laws. Y'all are looking really serious. Because you know it can't happen. It's impossible. We fail this, don't we? Mm-hmm. Wasn't that the whole kind of idea of the Old Testament, the old law, the old commands of God is basically showing them they couldn't keep it, right? That's the reality or the outcome, but he still commanded it. So we're in trouble, aren't we? We got a problem.
But Jesus.
But, I love that, but Jesus, but God, yes, but. There's a big old wonderful contrast there, isn't there?
Great study to do everything.
But God, I agree. Go just as you read through Mark and make a list, that would be a great study. It's his uprightness, it's his standard. It's not impossible in the sense that he can keep it, but it's impossible for us as humans. But. There's a huge bet. Go back to power. Go back to salvation. Where does this come from? It comes from God.
Absolutely.
How does it get to us?
Through Christ.
Through Christ. Through what he did. Through salvation. By grace. Through faith. I mean, all of that.
And through the Word.
Through the Word. Studying the Word and understanding that and changing over and over. As we talk about this present aspect of salvation, that's our sanctification, that's this changing time, this process that we're in, right? But it was Sandy, I think, that said justification is all over this, right? Being right with God is what Martha called it. That's absolutely true. It's within the word, right with God. The justification is just before God, right? If you are justified, which means you have, God has found you just, you are in right relationship with God. That's what the justified or justification is. As a result of justification, you have righteousness. They're tied together. As a result of salvation, you have righteousness. And that, we got to stop. We got to understand. This doesn't come from within me. Now, there is a use of this word that does have to do wrongly, a wrong use of this word, that does have to do with us. It, all people think what? We have our own set of rules, don't we?
Self-righteousness.
We have self-righteousness, right? The Pharisees are a great group to look at and point fingers at, and certainly we can learn a lot from that, but don't start thinking you're not one of them. Mm-hmm. But the Pharisees had their own set of rules. They would have told you they were righteous, and right, they had righteousness. They would have told you that because they had that set of rules, and they were really good at keeping their set of rules and their ways. Okay, that's the idea of transgression, or it's not lawlessness in the same way, because that they do have laws, they do have a standard. So it's not lawlessness like, I have no laws, I live however. It's the idea of a standard, but it's not God's standard. It's a standard they can achieve. And they probably weren't doing real well with it either, but they like to think they were. They were certainly better than everybody else. Sound familiar? Mm-hmm. Can we be like that? And God says, my righteousness is what? Filthy rags. And as ladies, you can understand, better than most, filthy rags are menstrual cloths. Mm. The nasty, blood-soaked nastiness. Not just coming out of you, but take it in a field and bury it. And then go back for it about 15 years later, stroke that thing off. Mm. That's how God views our righteousness. Can't get it. I mean, you can't make a picture that's bad enough to understand the filth of our righteousness. As opposed to God's righteousness. Perfect, pure, nothing wrong with it. And we on our own cannot attain it. The only way I can have righteousness is that he has taken away my sin. I'm clean and pure. For a second. I'm clean and pure. And he pours into me what? His righteousness. His righteousness in me. And now I can live by that standard. Goes back to this. Now, in the present, I can be righteous. I am righteous, therefore I can live righteousness. We have no excuses. That's the part of what this takes away. We had all kinds of excuses prior to salvation. Couldn't do it. I'm not going to try. Why bother? You know, somebody tells you up front, you're not going to fly out that window and, you know, hit the interstate without, you know, ever touching the ground between here and 75. You can't do that. So, why bother trying? But if God said that's what you want to do, I want you to do it. If God said that is exactly what I want you to do, clear and you know it, will it happen? Mm-hmm. All you do is participate. He can make that happen. I cannot. It's any impossibility that you can think about. He can make it happen. Now, he's not asking me to fly to Sweetwater without, you know, fly to 75 without. He's not asking me to do that. Just making up any impossible situation. If he chose that that was what I was going to do, it is, he is a, mm-hmm.
It's
me.
Like the walking on water.
Yes.
And you have the little faith.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's the greatest picture, and it's biblical. It's better than mine. Yes, Peter steps out of the boat and does the impossible, and he did it on faith. Yes, he trusted and believed that the person telling him, that was doing it too, the person that told him to do it, could make it happen. And then he starts sinking. Why did he start sinking?
Because he got scared.
He got scared.
Lost
he started
faith.
Thinking
lost
about his feet.
Faith was fading.
Yes. And he took his eye, he literally took his eyes off Jesus, looked down at his feet, and was kind of like, how did I get here? And even then, he cries out, and Jesus saves him from that. Mm-hmm. Saves him from the circumstance. But this righteousness is according to God's standard. It's not our standard. Don't ever make it your standard. But it's conforming to that. It is a requirement. He commands it. It is a requirement. And yet, on our own, it's impossible. So do you see the dependency that we have with him?
Total.
All the time?
Total dependence.
Yeah, total dependency. Yes, and just...
I found this definition. Righteousness is a gift from God.
Yes.
When we believe. Is a present reality in our lives. And is a future hope towards which we aspire.
Absolutely.
It goes
right back to this past, present, and future, doesn't it? These words cannot really be separated, but we can look at each one of them and what they have to do with, but they're all together. It's absolutely a gift of God. It has. I can't stress enough. I cannot drum this up in me. Remember, we were dead in our trespasses and sin, but God. We were dead in our trespasses. Dead. Not kind of sort of dead. Not just like lazy and laying around and give me some sugar and I can jump back up. No, dead. See yourself that way. Dead in your trespasses and sin. Not just you were going to die because of them. You were spiritually dead. Okay, you're dead. You're laying on the ground dead. And I come walking by. Do you wake up and go, could you wake me up? Could you give me mouth to mouth? You're not gasping and somebody understands that and gives you mouth to mouth. You're dead. Okay? Jesus comes and resuscitates you, literally breathes himself into you. Yes, you are, he does that, but I didn't ask for it. I didn't ask for it. Didn't deserve it. Didn't ask for it. Couldn't ask for it. If you did revive me and say, do you want it? I wouldn't have told you. You know, it's not anywhere in us. I can't stress that enough. It's not anywhere in us. Okay? You might have been a good person by almost everyone's standards. But God, not by his standard, were you good. Jesus said, why do you call me good? Only the Father is good. Jesus even said that. Mm-hmm. So don't think of yourself as good prior to salvation. You weren't. Worm dirt, remember? I had a friend who said that. Even this prayer today is like, you can't find a picture that's lower than lower than lower to get you low enough and in your relationship and understanding of your relationship to God. So I had a friend that said worm dirt. Not just dirt, but worse than in dirt. Below the dirt, worm dirt. You're just beneath contempt, beneath everything. It's not in you. So what Sadie was saying, it's gifted to you at your salvation. In order for you to even respond to salvation, don't even begin to think that I had it in me to respond. You didn't. You were dead. Remember that part? You had to be awakened enough to respond. And it was given to you. You were quickened, as it sometimes was called. You were awakened spiritually enough that when the gift was handed to you, you could receive it. You did receive it, by the way. You did do that. You accepted it. You received it. But he had to provide for it while you were laying there dead. He had to walk past. He had to breathe enough into you to waken you up enough for you to then breathe in more and inhale and receive. You didn't have anything in you for salvation. Strip that out of your minds. This is something I do, but it's something I had to do long ago. And it's a beautiful thing. I mean, it takes you really, really low, but it's a beautiful thing. Because for whatever reason, God did reach down and revive you. God did reach down and offer you salvation. Not because some person had persuasive words and they had the power in them, but somebody was used, right? There was someone that spoke the words to you. And that's our goal. That's our responsibility. But it's God's righteousness. And the picture of Jesus on the cross and all the weight of all sin of all time, it's not just the weight of it. He became it. This perfect, pure, never touched it, never was sinful, never had done anything, did not deserve to be on the cross, became it. Can you imagine? His entire being writhing because that sin is him now. The revulsion he had to have felt on the cross. And the rejection where God had to look away. And leaving there. If you want to understand the seriousness of sin, understand that God, in his justice, could not let us get by with sin and find some way around it to get to him. It sounds like it when we think we don't have to pay for our sins. Jesus paid all of it for us. How serious is God about sin?
Very
serious. That not only God Jesus paid it, but God Father made him go through that. Remember in the garden, God Jesus said, if you could, if there was another way, take the cup from me. But not my will, but yours be done. Just let that sit on you for a minute. Because sometimes we take it so casually. Wasn't it great? There was that moment. There was some beautiful music. I just easily said yes to the gift. We don't even understand this, really, not at this depth. So this beauty of it is in our present sanctification. As you walk from this moment forward, or as you came in the door with some of this information, you can't be the same. You can't be the same. How could someone say, I'm saved and the past is paid for and I live however I want? Remember how I was talking about Jesus' entire being writhing because of the nastiness of sin that he became for you and me? That's how you should feel about it. That's how I should feel about any sin. In this, again, you've bought a car. It's beautiful. It's shiny. You park it in a parking lot and somebody bangs the side of it with their door and you got a dent now. You know, that first dent kills you, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay? Think about you as that perfectly cleaned up, Jesus poured his righteousness into you. You're perfectly clean for like half a second in your moment in your life before you move. before anything else comes along. But you can go back to that moment by confessing your sins, because he's faithful and just, just to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. All. Not to some. All. And don't hang on to that, well, this one's not so bad, I can continue in it. If you consciously do that, you're in trouble. We do that, don't consciously. You know, ask God to ask you. Righteousness. What a concept. What an amazing thing. Gift from God. We got to put that up there. It's a gift. Tell me it again. Gift from God.
When we believe.
When we believe, right?
It's a present reality in our lives.
Present reality.
And a future hope towards which we aspire.
We aspire, right?
Right.
Has to do, again, past, present, and future. We have a tendency to continue on in our Christian walk, forgetting that we're presently in this path and in this process. And understand that, again, as I try to describe my righteousness as filthy rags in some sort of way, I was trying, possibly, to get to God based on that. Okay, being right with God is that idea of getting to God. Getting into heaven is another thought and process. And so if you take that kind of spiritual line, and zero is here, and that's negative righteousness, and that's positive righteousness. Negative righteousness is what we're born in, what we live in, prior to our salvation. But even that, Jesus paid for all of this. Everything he did, took care of, paid the debt for, and the penalty of, an all unrighteousness for all time. All. It was sufficient. Complete and sufficient. But if there was a way it took me to zero, that's paid for. I'm fine. I don't have any debt anymore. I'm fine. You don't get into heaven on zero. Yeah, you got to have the positive righteousness, and that's that righteousness, and it comes from God. It's a gift from God, provided through the cross, provided through Jesus. It's that exchange of robes we talked about with David and Jonathan. Remember, I take off mine, and I put on Christ's righteousness. So when God views me, he sees Jesus' righteousness applied to me, given to me as a gift. And it is a present reality that we can walk in, and there's the future hope, because that's what gets us to heaven. Right? Awesome. Okay, there's so much that we could do. Interesting, one more thing. Interesting, this word instead of righteousness used to be called right wiseness. You're right wise. Okay, think of it. That's kind of like an old phrase. All right? If this was, I don't know, something was upside down. Well, we use the term, you write something, right? In other words, you set it upright. Yes. Put it back into square or whatever. If something is upside down, you turn it right side up. We use these terms all the time. So it's that idea of right wiseness, meaning God's righteousness as exhibited in the death of Christ, which is sufficient to show men that God is neither indifferent to sin nor regards it lightly. On the contrary, it demonstrates that quality of holiness in him, which must find expression in his condemnation of sin. And that's what I was talking about a minute ago. His expression of condemnation of sin is Jesus dying on the cross, sending his son. There had to be a payment. And no matter what, I was going to pay for my sins by eternal separation from God. I couldn't pay for my sins and never get in heaven. There was nothing I could do. We were hopeless. But God. Okay, faith. Is that the next one?
Revealed.
Revealed. Okay. So what's revealed?
Apocalypse. Oh, yeah. Apocalypse.
A-P-K-A-L-U-P? Okay.
I think that's what I've got.
Yeah, it's 601, and it's A-P-O-K-A-L-U-P-T-O. That's the way I've got it written.
Yeah.
Okay, so what is this referring to?
To uncover.
Uncover, right?
To unveil something previously unknown.
Okay. Unveil previously unknown.
To take off the cover.
Okay. Uncover or take off the cover.
Disclose.
Disclose.
Okay. What did this remind you of? Did it remind you of anything that we studied in our past? Our
Revelation.
Revelation.